bring to you the word. Be anchored to Jesus. Be anchored to Jesus. And we're going to read about four scriptures I want to take you to and talk you through. Then I'm going to bring you to the main scripture. The main scripture is going to be from Hebrews chapter 6, verses 13 to 19. But I'm going to read a couple of verses before that. So the first verses I'm going to be reading from is Genesis chapter 14, verses 18 to 20. Praise God. And it says, "And Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought forth bread and wine." Say bread and wine.
Bread and wine.
Amen. "And he was the priest of the Most High God. And he blessed him and said, blessed be Abraham of the Most High God, possessor of heaven and earth. And blessed be the Most High God, which have delivered thine enemies into thine hand." And he gave him a tithe of all. So Melchizedek came to Abraham and said, "Abraham, I'm going to bless you. You are blessed." And Abraham accepted the blessing and he gave 10% of all of his spoils from the war. And then in Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 to 3. "Now the Lord had said to Abraham, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto the land which I will show you. And I will make thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and I will curse him that curseth thee. And in thee shall all the families," say all the families, "of the earth be blessed." But then Paul picks it up in Galatians chapter 3, verse 8 and 9. And it says, "And the scripture foreseeing God would justify the heathen through faith, preached before the gospel unto Abraham." So God was the first preacher. Amen. God was the first preacher. "So he preached unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all nations be blessed. So then, they which be of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham." Amen. Also, look at verse 28 and 29 of that same chapter. Paul went on to say to the Galatians, "There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither bond nor free, there is neither male or female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus." Aren't you pleased about that? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God has got the perfect plan for equal opportunities.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. "And if ye be in Christ," say if you are in Christ, "then you are Abraham's seed." Hallelujah. "And heirs," that means you have a right to inherit it, "according to the promise that God gave to Abraham." Say amen.
Amen.
So if you got that then, so Abraham was blessed by the high priest and blessed by God. And Paul was explaining to us that if we are of Abraham's seed. Now, Abraham was a Hebrew. And people think this only belongs to the Jews. But that's not true. Because if we read other parts of the Bible, it says, "And the Gentiles to be blessed." That's us who are not Jews are also blessed in Abraham. So all the promises that Abraham has, we too can claim.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Keep the theme in your mind. Be anchored to Jesus. So now I've given you a little bit of the background. Let's go then to Hebrews, our main scripture. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 13 to 19. It says, for when God made promise to Abraham, because he could not swear by no greater, he swore by himself, saying, surely blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thee. God is saying there's a blessing that he has for us. And the mathematical equation or sign that he used was not minus. It was not division. It was not plus. But it was the multiplication. God says, I'm ready to bless you, but I'm going to multiply it in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Your blessing shall be multiplied. And so he waited patiently, endured, he obtained the promise. Amen. I'm here to encourage somebody. I know it's difficult times. This is COVID and it's difficult. I've been saying this like it sounds like I'm saying it every week. But we need to endure it and believe that our promise is in Christ Jesus. And that's why you must be anchored to Jesus. Come on, let's wait patiently for the promise. Amen. For men verily swear by the greater. Amen. That word verily means truly. So men truly swear by which is greater. Amen. And an oath for confirmation is to them an end to all strife. Let me explain this. So basically, those who have brought a house and you've got your mortgage, or you've brought a car and you've got it on hire purchase, what you are doing in effect, you are signing and making a declaration of swear that I will continue to pay the payments. And by you signing that declaration, it says if you fail to pay the payments, they have the right to take away your house. And they have a right, or they have a right to take away your car. Is that correct? But in this case, God made a promise. And because there was nobody greater than him. Why? Because the God is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. There is nobody above him. There is nobody who can get around him. Come on. Because God is the true and living God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There is no other God besides me, saith the Lord God. All other gods are idols, but Jehovah is the true and living God. Hallelujah. He's the same God who rescued Daniel from the lion's den. Come on, are we talking to you? He's the same God who delivered Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego from the fiery furnace. It's the same God who delivered Israel out of Egypt. And that same God is our God today. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give God praise. You see, God is multifaceted. Do you know that? He can heal anyhow, anywhere, anytime. Nothing restricts God. Nothing can go above God. I'm not talking to somebody. I said the promise was made to Abraham, and if your faith is in Christ Jesus, then you are the seed of Abraham. Hallelujah. Praise God. So God could not find anybody greater than himself. Hallelujah. So he swore by his own name. Hallelujah. Praise God. And the Bible said that an oath for confirmation is to them an end of all strife. You see, if I promise you to give you my car and you sign it, hallelujah, at the back of your mind, because you signed it and I signed it, you know that it's going to end all strife, because you signed it to say that if you don't give me this car now, I can take it. And that's what God has done. It ends all strife. Hallelujah. Praise God. Wherein God willingly, more abundantly, to show unto the heirs of promise the immutability of his counsel, confirmed it by an oath. Let me tell you what immutability means. Anything that is immutable means it cannot be changed. Oh, glory, hallelujah. You see, Satan wants to change it by telling you you can't make it. Satan wants to give you doubt and tell you that you can't do this, you might as well just give up. But God is saying, the promise that I've given to you, I'm not going to change it. I don't lie. I am the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Amen. Continue, verse 18. Listen to this. That by two immutable things in which it was impossible, say impossible, for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation. So we don't need to fear. Amen. We don't need to fear, because if God said it, it's going to happen. If God promised you, it's going to come. It may not come the way you expect it to come. Oh, glory, hallelujah. But it's coming. You better be assured, it's coming. Listen, listen. The devil can't stop it. Man can't annul it. Hallelujah. Because God said it. If you believe it and you trust in God, your blessing is going to come. Oh, my God, hallelujah. I sit saying for a few weeks, there is a turnaround coming in somebody's life. Oh, I'm telling you, there's a turnaround coming in somebody's life. Because there's a promise for you, my sister. And God says, I'm not taking it back. It's yours. There's a promise for you, my brother. Your faith must be in Jesus Christ. The Bible says, all those who have faith in Christ are heirs of the promise. But by two immutable things, it is impossible for God to lie. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. People sometimes think that the first thing is God cannot lie. What's the second thing? But people misunderstand that. What it means is that there are two things that God has done which he will not lie and turn back on. That's the promise and the oath. Amen. Hallelujah. Some people also say that it's the bread and the wine, hallelujah, which represents the body and the blood of Jesus Christ, hallelujah. So the Bible says, who fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us. Hope is not wishful thinking. The Christian hope is a surety. Are you getting that? We say today, I hope to see you tomorrow. That means you may see them, you may not see them. In today's language. But in the biblical language, whenever you see the word hope, it means it is definitely going to happen. So when we sing, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness, we are saying that our hope, our trust is in Jesus Christ. We do not have to bow down, for our trust is in Jesus Christ. And the hope is set before us. Oh, I'm talking to somebody. That promise is set before you. Oh, I'm talking to somebody. I said, that hope, that promise is set before you. Verse 19. Hallelujah. Which hope, and this hope that is set before us, we have as an anchor. Oh, glory, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Of the soul. Both sure and steadfast, and which entereth into that within the veil. You see this ship here? This ship is like our lives. Amen. Hallelujah. Things come our way and rocks us. Oh my God. And we feel like we're almost going to fall out of the ship. We feel like as though we want to give up. We feel like as though there's no hope. I'm talking to somebody. Come on, is the winds of life blowing against your life? Come on, I want to talk to somebody. Well, God says, hallelujah, don't you worry. Make sure your hope is anchored, hallelujah, to Christ. Amen. It's blowing left, right, and center. But Jesus has stepped in, and Jesus is saying to the boat, and he's saying to the seas and the wind, peace be still. Hallelujah. Did you know the word that Jesus used, the Hebrew word, if you translate it, when the boat was rocking to and fro, Jesus said, Shalom Rapha. Hallelujah. Which means peace be still. Hallelujah. Oh, come on. I believe there's some people in here because God doesn't give me a message just by coincidence. This is God incidents. God is saying that the winds of life are blowing in your life right now. They're blowing in your family's life. They're blowing in your relationships. Come on. They're blowing over your children's life. They're blowing over your partner's life. They're blowing in your marriage. Come on. They're blowing everywhere. They're blowing everywhere. And the winds are tossing your boat left, right, and center. You're about to hold on. Can you see this picture? You're about to hold on. The sea. Oh, come on. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Spirit. You see, what the devil wants is for you to fall into the sea. Oh, glory, hallelujah. He wants you to fall into the sea. But I give you a word from the Holy Spirit. Don't leave the boat. Come on, come on. Don't leave the ship. Don't leave the ship. For God says, in that very ship, what the Satan is battering and the wind is battering, there I'm going to perform my miracle. Right in that place. Oh, glory, hallelujah. Right in that place, God says, I am going to perform my miracle. A miracle is coming. A miracle is coming to somebody. Oh my God, give God praise. I said, a miracle is coming. Because the promises of God are sure. In Jesus' name, you will be set free. Amen. So the ship is battering, as you can see. You don't know what to do. But Jesus has said, Shalom, Rapha, to the sea. Oh, glory, hallelujah. Oh, glory, hallelujah. Satan thinks he had you, but Jesus has whispered, Shalom. Satan has thought that he's going to kill you, but Jesus has whispered, Shalom. Satan thought that he stole all your finances, but Jesus has whispered, Shalom. Satan has thought that this sickness would not leave you. You would not be delivered from this sickness, but Jesus has whispered, Shalom, Shalom. You may think things are not going well, but I'm here to bring a word, and I'm here to tell you with confidence that your deliverance is at hand. Your deliverance is now, but you must have your faith in Christ Jesus. Oh, glory, hallelujah. If the bishop fail, I've still got my own relationship. If the pastor fail, I've still got my own relationship. Let me tell you something. God wants you to know that your relationship with God is what's going to keep you. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I love my wife dearly, but my faith is not in Pastor Debbie. I love my friends, but my faith is not in my friends. My faith is not in the bank manager. My faith is not in money. My faith is not in riches. Oh, glory, hallelujah. But my faith, oh God, my faith is in Jesus Christ. No wonder the person who sat at the temple beautiful, the Bible said he was lame since birth. So the Bible said that the lame man sat at the gate beautiful. In Acts chapter 3. Oh, glory, hallelujah. Praise God. Can we go to him? Because the Holy Spirit is leading me down this road. Praise God. Hallelujah. And the man sat there at the gate beautiful. And the Bible says Peter and John, hallelujah, went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. Ninth hour in the Bible is 3 p.m. And a certain lame man, which from his mother's womb, from birth, oh, that's the presence of the Holy Spirit. Something's happening here. Oh, something is happening in this place. The presence of the Holy Spirit is right here. It's right here. And the lame man who was lame from his mother's womb was carried, and whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful. The Bible says he was there to ask alms. That's ask for money. Ask for money. Amen. And they entered into the temple. Glory, hallelujah. And seeing Peter and John, let me say something. Peter and John just came out of a mighty revival called the Day of Pentecost. They were full of fire. Oh my God, I feel like I want to preach. They were full of fire and anointing by the presence of the Holy Ghost. So the Bible says Peter and John were about to go into the temple. And Peter fastened his eyes upon him. Hallelujah. With John. Oh, glory, hallelujah. And said, lame man, look on us. look on us. And he looked at them. The lame man looked at them, expecting to get some money. Oh, glory, hallelujah. And then Peter said, silver and gold have I none. I don't have no money to give you right now, but such as I give you is something better than silver, something better than gold. But what I want to give you, hallelujah, is the name of Jesus. So in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, I'm talking to somebody. In the name of Jesus, don't give up, my brother. Don't give up. God's not finished with you yet, saith the Lord God. God's not finished with you yet. You feel like you want to give up and just give up everything. But God says, I'm not finished with you yet. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And the Bible said that Peter and John took the right hand and lifted him up. And he leaping up, stood and walked and entered where? The temple that he was outside every day. Now he stands up and he goes into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. Come on, do you know what I'm talking about? When God has done something for you, you must know what God has done for you. Amen. He was walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God. Is that powerful? Is that powerful? Amen. So right now, your ship has been tossed to and fro. Oh, I'm talking to somebody. But God says he will not go back on his promise. He cannot lie about his promise and about his oath. It remains the same yesterday, today, and forever. We have a hope as an anchor of the soul. I used to think a long time ago that the anchor was Jesus. The anchor is not Jesus. The anchor is our faith and hope in Christ. The anchor has to latch on to the rock, which is Jesus. So may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. And the church says, amen.